Well, thank you, Jim. Thanks very much for welcoming us to this beautiful facility, and we will have a chance later in the day to get over on the campus, and I very much look forward to that. Okay, good. Well, it's my pleasant task to welcome you to the Symposium on Teaching and the Digital Humanities. I've been president of the American Academy since July, and this is my first trip to Georgia and to Atlanta in my new capacity, and I'm really delighted to see such a good turnout and to be on this wonderful campus. Ron, thank you so much. This idea, I think, came at our October induction, and you suggested that we should come to Atlanta, and I think you tactfully pointed out it had been a long time, 1979, since we'd been here, and you not only were, shall we say, gracious, but also persistent, and so we're here because of you, and we thank you very much, and I want to make a public declaration here, but I'll make it to you. We're going to come more frequently. We're not going to... We're not going to let so much time pass, and of course it's going to be expensive for Emory if each time we come, a new major building. and we were talking at breakfast this morning about some some plans. In any case, we're here mainly for this occasion, but in the afternoon we will have a meeting of the American Academy's Lincoln Project. The Lincoln Project is examining ways to preserve and strengthen our nation's public research universities at a time when government support is shrinking. And so we have a number of participants here with us who will be part of our program this afternoon, but I especially want to call out Robert Bergineau, who is the Chancellor Emeritus of Berkeley, and Mary Sue Coleman, the President Emerita of the University of Michigan, who are the co-chairs of our project. As some of you will know, the Academy was founded in 1780 during the American Revolution by John Adams, James Bowdoin, John Hancock, and others, people who really wanted to help the new nation get established, get a constitution, a Bill of Rights, and a set of values that could be informed over time by bringing together leaders from all disciplines, not just academics, in the strong belief that a republic that's healthy, that survives and prospers, has to be grounded on open discourse, engaged scholarship, and an informed and active citizenry. And so over time, the Academy did expand to include, as it does now, business leaders, people in philanthropy, people in government, people in the military, as well as academics who come together to address topics that are both timely but also abiding. And we like, when we can, to be a little ahead of the curve. And I think this conversation today speaks to our desire to be there, present at the creation or early, in discussing a topic of importance. A little history here. The first Academy Fellow to be elected from the state of Georgia was Atticus Green Haygood, a name that will be familiar to most of you. Haygood was president of Emory from 1875 to 84. His inspirational words, "Let us stand by what is good and make it better if we can," are etched above the Haywood Hopkins gate that welcomes students and visitors to this campus. And I believe those words are a perfect epigram for our program this morning. Humanities education, properly understood, is our attempt to transmit what is good from one generation to the next. And the digital revolution has offered us new ways to make humanities education better, more accessible, more interactive. And like Haywood, we should be cautious in our optimism about the digital future. Not every innovation is an improvement or comes without unintended consequences. We should make things better if we can, his words, but I think we can. I really do think we can. And I believe this morning's conversation will justify my optimism. This morning's program is inspired by the work of the Academy's Commission on the Humanities and Social Sciences, which was formed in response to a call from Senators Lamar Alexander and Mark Warner and Representatives David Price and Tom Petrie. And the challenge was to assess the state of the humanities and social scientific scholarship and education. The commission issued an influential report called The Heart of the Matter in 2013. And among its many recommendations, the report suggested several ways to broaden public and scholarly access to digital resources, including revised fair use and copyright regulations. And it also encouraged new partnerships to encourage and ensure that all students have access to quality online teaching materials, especially those in economically disadvantaged K-12 schools. And one of the outcomes of the Heart of the Matter and the reception that it received is a brand new request just received from a different bipartisan group of senators and representatives asking the Academy to undertake a follow-on study of language education in America. That project is about to get underway, but we expect that digital tools will play a significant role in recommendations to strengthen the nation's approach to language learning. These are important projects, and they surely reflect the interest and the expertise of our broad membership. I know we have a number of members in the audience, so let me say to you, the Academy is open for your ideas. We don't all have to have big studies. We can take an issue or two that requires simply a conversation, and we've established a fund to make it possible for you to bring together colleagues from different places and different disciplines to explore topics of interest to you. We'll do the organizing, we'll cover the cost, so come forward with your ideas. To begin our program now, it's my pleasure to introduce Erica Farr, Director of the Remarkable Digital Archives here at Emory, who will introduce our panel and moderate the discussion. In addition to leading the digital initiatives of the Manuscript Archives and Rare Book Library, Erica pursues her own research on human information behavior and the digital humanities. She's developing new and exciting ways to open digital source materials to researchers, exemplified by an innovative project that provides access to the writer Salman Rushdie's entire archive, including his computer hard drives. And I really will be interested to learn more about that. So, Erica, take it away.
Thank you.